Hi, I'm Shoma Chaudhary. Thank you for watching Inquiry and for joining me for part two of this conversation with Asaduddin Owaisi, chief of the Muslim Party AIMIM and someone who sees himself as a staunch constitutionalist. In the first part, we'd spoken of the anti-CA protests, we'd spoken about the Uniform Civil Code, Tablighi Jamaat and Triple Talaq. We'd also spoken about a new mood amongst Muslims and how they want to participate in a new way in Indian politics. In part two, we're looking at the arguments over an oppressive Muslim past, at communal speeches made by Muslim leaders, and also at the great churn that is taking place within Muslim society. Thank you very much for listening in. So Owaisi Saab, I'm going to go back a little bit to history because so much of the, you know, if you scratch below people's surface, the reason all these contemporary issues become so emotive is because there is this sense of a Muslim oppressive past. The Hindutva rhetoric plays a lot on those 700 years of Muslim rule and how devastating it was. Do you think that there have been mistakes in the way the Muslim rule in India has been addressed? Do you think there are more creative ways of addressing that period? And how would you personally address the fears that have been generated about that period?
You know, this question is asked to me many times, but how can I speak for Babur? How can I speak for Alauddin Khilji? How can I speak for Akbar or Shah Jahan or Aurangzeb? You know, I don't speak for them. Yes, it is part of our country, but how can I speak for what Ashoka did? And I know, how can I speak for what the Mauryas did? Why, you know, are you going to ask Soma Chaudhary all these questions? No, because it is obnoxious to ask anyone this question. And then when this frame of mind of RSS and BJP is when the Prime Minister, after getting elected and coming to the Parliament and giving his first speech in Parliament, he said, 1400 saal ki ghulami ke baad humko ye satta mili. What is that? The ghulami period was 200 years of British rule. How did the Prime Minister take it to the 1100 saal? Because that is his thought process of what the Hindu nationalists believe. How can I be answerable for what Babur did or what Humayun did or what Akbar did or what all the Muslim dynasties did? My whole argument is we fought for independence, for an inclusive India, and we gave ourselves this constitution, and that is what it is. My whole struggle is for constitutional rights. What he did or what he didn't do. Oh, he shouldn't have built Taj Mahal. He shouldn't have built Qutub Minar. He shouldn't have built Red Fort. Char Minar should not have been built. Ajanta Ellora Cave should not have been cleaned by the Nizam of Hyderabad. You know, where will it end? If you go back in history, even the Hindu kings demolished temples. Where will it end? You know, the Jains would say that you finished us. The Buddhists will say you finished us. And the constitution is the book for us. The Prime Minister only by words he says, oh, the constitution is supreme book to me. But when it comes to actual practice, he goes back to 1100 years.
Yeah, actually, I'm going to find it hard to argue with you because I also feel the same thing, that the medieval logic of a previous era is not something that any modern Muslim or modern Hindu can answer for, you know, and same way like Ashoka created devastation all the way up to Kalinga before he had a change of heart. Those are things that have happened, as you said, there are Hindu kings that betrayed each other, they destroyed each other's kingdoms, there was oppression, there was zamindari oppression. Modern Indians can hardly explain what their forefathers
did. This is the new book I bought.
Which is?
I was sent by, and in this book...
We can't see it. What is the book?
Now in this book, all cast of characters are given, and then who was the main general of Akbar who defeated Rana Pratap? It was a Hindu. And I hope those people should read this book. You know, there's so many books. The problem is, problem with Muslims now is that I carry this historical baggage of what the Muslim rulers did. You know, why should I be answerable for them? You know, was there a democracy over there? Was there a constitution over there? Was there a fundamental rights over there? These are all kings. These are all feudal kings who killed people on the whims and desires of a king. And I hope that the present Badshah of Delhi does not act like those kings. Because the constitution is a document which we gave to us.
No, absolutely. And also, it wasn't a monolithic time. You have characters like Malik Ambar who fought the Mughals. He was, like the Deccan Muslims were fighting the Mughal Muslims. So it was all very complex and layered, and every society has been built out of layers. So
the first battle of Panipat, Ibrahim Lodi and Babur, you have the Kashmir Chak King fighting against the Mughals, against Muslims only. So, BJP is trying to ensure that every ill which is there in India is because of what happened with the Muslim rule. So that is a completely wrong and fallacious argument to make.
So I wanted to ask you that, on what grounds do you see the political mobilization of Muslims now? There are two strands, and I've been hearing that from youngsters. There are those who want to mobilize or to speak in the language of the constitution. They want participation. They want fundamental rights. They just want to go about their lives protected as ordinary citizens. There are others who feel that it's time to crystallize the Muslim identity. There was all that controversy during the anti-CA protests, also when there was a small group that raised the slogan of La Ilahi, and saying that that's the bond between all of us. Which route do you think the community is going to go? Which is the more dominant route? Are there internal arguments going on within the community on these paths?
The reality is that many Muslims are still unfortunately stuck with the secular parties. Because unless and until we come out of this complex of being captive or hostage to the secular parties, nothing good will come out of or nothing good will happen to the Muslim community. We should stop being the only community which is being given the responsibility of stopping communalism. These are issues. As far as communalism is concerned, the Muslim should realize that you cannot be a coolie of secularism. This is a responsibility which has to be equally shared by every Indian who believes in Indian nationalism. Now, Muslims feel very proud. Oh, no, no, humko rokna hai firqa parasti ko. I ask them, kab tak rokenge aap? You have failed in stopping BJP. You take Congress party, Maharashtra elections. I was criticized in every public meeting by Congress, NCP, that OAC BJP se mila hua hai, Shiv Sena se mila hua hai. OAC court mat do, BJP Shiv Sena ko harao. Stop BJP and Shiv Sena. After elections, you go and join Shiv Sena. You forget about Sri Krishna Committee Commission's report. So that is the problem now. The main problem is with the Muslim community. So once they come out of this complex of, oh, we have to vote for secular parties, I keep on telling them that even inshallah, let us hope that in 2024 a new government comes. But Muslim marginalization would be more. This hatred, this poison has perpetrated at the grassroots level. It is not going to change so quickly. So Muslims must realize this and come out of this complex, take active political participation, make political alliances and win from those seats where you can win. And that is where that can be a launching pad or a starting point of this great change which Muslim community requires.
But Owaisi Saab, I would ask you a counter question to that, which is that, forgive me if it sounds naive, but is it
possible... Please be blunt with me. No.
Okay. No, that, do you think that if the Muslim community consolidates as a Muslim vote, and so what's been very interesting about the Indian experiment is that no Muslim-based party has ever won a large share of the vote, because Muslims did believe that they could participate as citizens, and it's actually the secular parties who let them down. But because there is now a new consciousness, there is a new young generation hungrier, more connected, more information-based, do you think that it might be more positive if Muslims began to vote on governance issues so that all parties would have to take them seriously? Because otherwise you will continue to be ghettoized.
Madam, they have been voting on all the issues which you have said. That has led to the disaster. They have been voting for all those issues which you have just mentioned. Governance, secularism, security, equity, development of their locality, hoping to have more schools. But everything has been shattered. Muslims have been voting on these issues, but what is it that you get? And had Mr. Swamy been there in this debate, I would have asked him that had he not said that BJP doesn't get vote on development but on Hindutva. BJP does that. BJP openly says that, and BJP is doing that. And where is, so governance, every issue of governance, Muslim voted. But what is it that I have got? I have more numbers in under trial in prisons. I have my, now the deliberate targeting is done of Muslim educated youth. Who's my future? Who are my backbone? You know, they are being targeted. And who are the secular parties who are standing with me? None. I have been abdicated. I have been thrown to the dogs that, okay, now it is you. If you survive, fine with you. And if you live, okay, you live to vote for us again. That cannot be the case. So Muslims have been voting for issues of governance. They have never voted for their development. They have never voted for their empowerment. They have never voted for their to solve the illiteracy problems. They have never voted to solve their equity problems. That has not been the case.
But tell me, VC Saab, that might be a blind spot for me also, but are you saying that there are no government schools in Muslim areas? There's also been, you know, argument over why madrasas can't have more modern education. So the question that I would put to you is that why would Muslims not be able to progress without the direct largesse of government? Not in terms of employment, because if you really look at it, whether it's Jats or whether it's Patels or, you know, whether it's Dalits, almost every community in India feels that it's not well done by. And nobody really feels that enough is being done for them. So to that extent, maybe more and more the government is not able to provide on the issues of human rights. I totally agree with you. There is definitely a greater, you know, there's a kind of prejudice against young Muslims. And we've seen that even when Congress governments and before the BJP came to power, it's got escalated now. But in terms of just progress, every part of this country feels, and we've seen that now, 90% of this country lives such precarious lives. You know, those migrant workers, there's no Hindu Muslim in that. There's just millions and millions of people who are themselves living very, very precarious lives. So is there any other way of articulating this which is not deeply located in just being Muslim?
Number one point is that you're absolutely right. When it comes to migrant laborers, there's no Hindu Muslim. But in that migrant laborers, you will not find any upper caste Hindu over there. You will find Dalits, you will find tribals, you will find OBCs. But they have political voice. They have their political representation to take up their issues. When you say schools are not being opened up, it's a fact. There are no schools. And let me quote you from Kundu committee report, which was given to Najma Hepatullah in 2014 October, that the highest dropout rate is among the Muslims. And why do they drop out? They give factors of dropout. The important reason was that there is no financial wherewithal to study in schools. Now, you have empirical studies which point to illiteracy, which points out of school children, which points to that why is it out of 100 only 3 are Muslim graduates? Definitely the government has a role to play. I agree with you about employment, you know, to a certain extent. But why don't you open schools?
Let me complete.
I give an example of my state. In my state of Telangana, we went and met our Chief Minister K. Chandrasekhar Rao after the creation of state, and he asked me, Asad bhai, kya karna hai? La sir, schools kholo musalmanon ke liye. This was in 6 years ago. Then we had meetings to cut it short. Now the government has opened residential schools for Muslims. And you know how many boys and girls are studying? 80,000 Muslim boys and girls are studying in those residential schools. And they're getting grades. After qualifying from 12th standard, they are getting into medicine, engineering. Who stopped them? Why don't you open schools? Secondly, about Mr. Modi's so-called promises about Muslim empowerment. I have been asking that the scholarship given to minorities, not Muslims, please make it demand-driven. Why? Because a study was done by the Ministry of Minority Affairs, which said that because the scholarships are not demand-driven, nearly 30-40 lakh of Muslim boys and girls are not getting scholarship. You don't have financial wherewithal. This is where systemic discrimination is happening. and this has to be addressed. And that can only be addressed if you have political representation. You don't have political representation, you have only one mad person by the name of OSU shouting and shouting. But if you have 10 to 12 MPs like me in parliament, things will definitely change. Because in Telangana, we have changed because you had an active chief minister who believed in actual secularism, and the results are there to be seen in Telangana. Why can't this example of Telangana be replicated?
So, Ovesi Saab, that's a great example, but barring this issue of schools, in all other schemes of government, whether it's the food security, whether it's the health insurance, whether any of the schemes which are now towards creating a welfare state, are Muslims excluded from that?
Madam, as far as schemes are concerned, at least 20% should be for the minorities. I have been a member of the standing committee, and I can tell you the reports are public now. Those targets are never met. The reason being that the Muslim, Dalits, tribals don't have political voice. You know, I'm reminded of what Baba Saheb Ambedkar said when the same question was asked about Dalit representation. He said, Baba Saheb, there are Dalit MPs in parliament. He said, you are absolutely right. Then they said, why are you arguing? He said, yeah, their only duty is, you know, when they open their mouths only to yawn, he said. Can you believe that reservation was given to upper caste communities and all those 190 odd Dalit MPs, you know, just kept quiet? Where the soul of Baba Saheb was being thrown to tatters, they kept quiet. That is why I feel that this democracy of ours requires not Benami ki leadership, but Naam ki leadership. Who can stand up and raise his issues? And that will only happen when Dalits, Muslims realize that you are living in a Benami leadership.
Is there another way of creating a Muslim middle class which will have voice, because then they are no longer, you know, just like the BJP is now creating a sense of being victims in the Hindu majority community, which is very harmful. Is there some way where Muslims can move out of feeling victims 70 years later in the country and just claim being citizens, you know? One thing I would like to say, Ovesi Saab, is that when the anti-CAA protests happened, it wasn't only Muslims who came out. There were Indians across the board who came out and stood neck to neck, you know? So it, of course, there was a majority and a large number of Muslims, but many Hindus also came out saying that, you know, this was isolating and discriminatory. So can that participation not be articulated only in terms of an alienating identity?
I completely disagree with you about when we raise issues of constitutional rights as being victims. No. If someone does it, I disagree with that. My whole struggle is that I'm not putting forward the victim. I'm saying, boss,
this is my right.
No. I'm not asking for moon. I'm not asking for stars. I'm saying, okay, please protect my masjid. Please don't garland my killers. Please open schools. And I'm saying that this othering of Muslims and portraying them as a different is an integral part of BJP's political ideology. That is what they're doing. So this, and I don't even want Soma Chaudhary or all the liberals which are with you to patronize me. What is enshrined to me in the constitution should be given to me. And I know that unless and until I wake up and fight for my constitutional rights, you're not going to give it to me. That is the crass reality of our democracy. So instead of being beggars, why don't you fight for equality and get a position wherein you can sit on a table and say, okay, this is what we want. You're absolutely right. The protests of CAA it was very inclusive. But that was only Soma Chaudhary. Where are the other people? You know, there are always 10 to 12% of Hindus who will always believe in an inclusive India, that no one can change that. But the reality also is that there were not many also over there. And that is why when that historical protest which was going on, which was bereft of all communalism, which was bereft of all hatred for any religion or anyone, unfortunately, the BJP turned it into a communal riot and gave it a bad name by arresting all these people.
we'll come to a close, but just one or two last questions that to just go back to history and this issue of mobilization. You know, always in Parliament, as I said at the beginning, it's wonderful to hear you, you know, even when you speak on TV debates, all of that, it's very measured, very informed. But when there's actual political mobilization happening, even by the AMIM, you know, mostly possibly I've heard it through your brother, and I'm not even going back to that one terrible statement he made of clearing the streets for 15 minutes of the police. That's been a millstone around your neck. I'm talking about the way he mobilizes in political rallies. I have heard him say that this is our country, but he claims it only through a Muslim past. You know, so he'll name Golconda, Taj Mahal, Qutub Minar, you know, Char Minar. He'll say, these are our monuments, this is our country, this is our past, and this is our, you know. So it is also, again, excluding anything which is Hindu. So when that kind of political mobilization happens on the ground, there's a disconnect between what one is saying on a public stage and what is actually happening on ground. And that's where tensions start building up. Do you think some introspection is required there?
You know, my younger brother had given many speeches. Yes, on that particular speech, he's facing a criminal case. But show me a speech wherein he was hauled up by Election Commission of India or he's facing a criminal case apart from that old ongoing case. But the specific example which you have given, you know, you must hear his complete speech. Don't go by the TRP things wherein the TV media wants to only hear the juicy part and they forget about what he said before or after that. The same Akbaruddin Owaisi went and met the chief minister and said, sir, in my constituency, I require 10 crores for expansion of a temple. The chief minister was so happy, he said, Akbar, you want it? I'll give it immediately. The same Akbaruddin Owaisi went and told the chief minister that in his constituency, there is a 400-year-old temple, which I have also written a letter to the chief minister that, sir, please protect that old temple. The same Akbaruddin Owaisi, in the time of COVID crisis, ensured that all the temples, the pujaris, and he didn't differentiate by distributing the food rations that, oh, I'll give it only to Muslims. He distributed around about 1 lakh food ration kits in his constituency. And we didn't see who's Muslim or Hindu or anyone, just give it, you know, because that was the, it is still a difficult time for everyone. So, you know, you're right, the perception has been created, but the reality is completely different. And also, let me also point out to you, if you are giving a public speech, I cannot speak by using this and I have to communicate with the masses. Yes, there has to be a line which no one should cross it, even in a public meeting. But, you know, when you speak in a public rally, I cannot speak to you what I speak in a public meeting in front of you or in a TV studio or in a parliament. There has to be a difference and you have to communicate.
That is the distinction which, you know, the BJP claims, because Mr. Modi will speak a certain way when he is addressing, you know, the League of Nations. And there'll be a different way that he speaks at an election rally. And the point...
Mr. Modi has only one point formula. That is, I am a Hindu nationalist. I will do whatever it takes to make this country a theocratic country. So, Mr. Modi can if he gets Muslims, he'll say something in Sufi conference. But when it comes to triple talaq, he said, "Aapka bhai hu." Now, what about who's the brother of Safura Zarghar now? Who's the brother of Safura Zarghar? You know, so Mr. Modi has 1 point program. I will not be fooled by what the honorable Prime Minister of mine is doing. But he the good thing about him is that he's very clear in what he's doing.
You had once said that why am I asked to condemn things which are extreme, say within the Muslim community, or when anyone makes a mistake, why do I have to condemn it? But the same way as Hindus or liberals are fighting Hindutva, it's the onus of everyone to constantly be calibrating your rhetoric in a way where you're not cornered into a situation by other people's excesses, you know. So why do you think that's
my request to the liberal people is that please accept me as a practicing Muslim. You know, That is what I demand. And my religious appearance does not mean that I believe in only religious symbols. I believe in the constitution. It is the constitution which allows me to be to practice my religion. The problem is that, and they should stop patronizing us. You know, the moment you stop patronizing me, that things will change, because you start from an elevated position. They don't know, bhaiya. Well, they live in all those places. They have 8 children. Whatever, come out of it. It is no more like that. You know, please treat me as equal. You will see that the whole battle will change.
If you were to put yourself in Hindu shoes and see what all has given rise to this kind of animus against Muslims, just as an exercise, have you ever tried to think what has created this animus towards Muslims in the Hindu mind? How would you dismantle it?
I would never put myself in those shoes, because I firmly believe that a Hindu has a right to be a Hindu, a Muslim has a right to be Muslim. But you know, the discussion, debate, arguments which I have with my Hindu friends is on these lines, that you know, don't get carried away by this vicious false propaganda being done by the BJP through their political organization, through their media sponsored, and then on social media. Don't get carried away, because you see, already there's enough division. You know, we are living in ghettos. You know, when I was a child, I had enough interaction with my Hindu friends. But that is what I want my son to have, those interaction, that becomes difficult now. You don't have Muslim and Hindu sharing houses as neighbors anymore now. On that point, I feel that, you know, there needs to be more interaction. There needs to be more meetings. Not on the lines of all those wars, national integration and all those tamasha for media. Real things should happen on the ground. And that can happen when people meet each other, understand each other. You're absolutely right. I also need to understand why Hindus are concerned about certain things. As far as Muslims are concerned, and when the most important point about terrorism, we always talk to them, we say we condemn it, but yes, there needs to be more understanding from both the sides. This environment will not allow that discussion to happen, because this environment is, you're either with me or opposing me. That this is what I call a George Bush environment. You're either with me or opposing me. So let us hope that this environment, which is more dangerous than the COVID virus, someday would come down, and we'll be able to sit down and discuss so many things and create all these misunderstandings which are there.
And just one last note to end on, that, you know, of, like you said, that there's a kind of blindness that has come up because we are so separated as communities now. We've kind of mentioned it in all our conversation, but if you were to sum it up, what is the one big churn that's happening within the Muslim community which people and media have been blind to?
The Muslim youth within the age of 18 to age of 40, there is a huge churning or a great desire, a burning desire for equality, for justice, for political empowerment. You know, that is a huge, huge thing which is going on. You know, people over 55 are still happy in the status quo, but the youth between the age of 18 to 38, 40, there's a huge change going on, a huge desire, a burning desire. You know, sometimes they get excited, sometimes, you know, they don't understand things and become very irrational. But this is what needs to be done. I hope the people in power, in powerful positions, will understand this, because if 65% of our population is under the age of 40, please understand this, that, you know, they also have aspirations as other Indians. Their aspirations are not different. They are completely on the same lines as other Indians. The only difference is that the religion is different.
Thank you so much, Oasis sir. Thank you.
Thank you.